We have a guest preacher in the house, so let us turn our eyes to the Amen.
Just a minute, only 60 seconds in it, forced upon me, can't refuse it, didn't seek it, didn't choose it, but it's up to me to use it. I must suffer if I lose it, give account if I abuse it. Just a tiny little minute, but an eternity is in it. Good morning, Crystal Cathedral. I'm honored to be here. How many of you know we've been in a challenging time here with the economy, not only here in America, but around the world for the last couple of years?
Quest for success and a quest for excellence, that's an unavoidable question. Sooner or later, you're going to have to answer that question.
This is my quest.
Follow that star,
no matter how hopeless.
I love talking to people through my books. And one of the books that we're going to focus on today is my book that literally has taken me around the world. It's called A Setback as a Setup for a Comeback. It's an international bestseller.
Mr. Willie Jolley. Welcome, Willie Jolley. Willie, I'm so glad to have you back.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. The best is yet to come. A setback is nothing but a setup for a comeback. And this is your time to come back.
Let us now receive one of our own, Minister Dr. Willie Jolley.
Amen. Well, I have only just a minute, only 60 seconds in it. Forced upon me, can't refuse it, didn't seek it, didn't choose it, but it's up to me to use it. I must suffer if I lose it, give account if I abuse it. Just a tiny little minute, but an eternity is in it. First, giving honor to my friend and my father. He's my mentor and my master. He's my light, he's my Lord. He's my rock, he's my redeemer. He's my source, he's my savior. He's my help, he's my hope. He's my guide, my God, my all in all. Amen. He was born in a small village. He had to be born in a stable because there was no room for him in the local hotel. He grew up in obscurity. For 30 years, he was a carpenter. At the age of 30, he became an itinerant preacher, going around sharing a new message of hope and love and possibility thinking. He did that for 3.5 years, never going more than 200 miles from the place where he was born. He never had a fancy house, a big car. He never had a college education. He had no credentials for himself, but himself. After 3.5 years, the public turned against him. His friends denied they even knew him. He was put up on trumped up charges, convicted of the charges, and sentenced to death. And many thought that would be the end of the story. But beloved, I've got good news for you today. 2,000 years have come and gone, and all the navies that ever sailed, and all the armies that ever marched, all the kings and queens and monarchies that ever sat, all the presidents and prime ministers that ever ruled have not had the impact on this world as that one solitary life. All that I do, all that I say, all that I am, he must first get the glory. His name is Jesus, and we give him praise. We give him praise. We give him praise. Hallelujah. I'm honored to be in this spot. I'm honored to be at this sacred desk. I'm honored for the opportunity to share my message with you. I got a call about midnight last night from our pastor. He said, Willie, My daddy's having surgery right now. He's having a procedure tonight. They can't wait. And so I would hope that you would be ready and prepared to give a word in the morning. And I said, Pastor, if you called me at 3 a.m., and if you said you needed, and I was in Japan, I'd do all I could to be here at the time you needed. Because we got a pastor who does for us. So anytime he needs. So what we're going to do is have a word of prayer right now. Get your neighbor's hand, name, and we're going to pray for each other. But we're going to pray for our pastor. We're going to pray for his father. We're going to pray to surround the whole Jenkins family. And that we will see God's power move right now. Let's pray. Let's go to prayer. Oh, Father, we thank you for this day. We glorify your name. We worship you and we give you the praise. We thank you for each person whose hand we're holding. We're praying for their health, their strength. We're praying for their family. We're praying for their finances. We're praying for their movement throughout this world, that they would be blessed and you put a hedge around them. That we're praying for our pastor, John Kenneth Jenkins Sr. We're praying for his wife, Trina, their children, the whole Jenkins family. And a special prayer, ministering angels, go to that hospital room right now. Put a hedge around that father and let him be recovering in a way that will astound the wise. They'll say, what happened here? They won't know that a church full of people in Glenarden are starting to pray. And prayer changes things. So God, we give you the glory. We give you the praise. We bless your holy name. And we call this done. We decree and declare it in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. And amen. Amen. Well, folks, this is the day. Y'all can be seated. Sit down. This is the day the Lord has made, and I shall rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. This is a good day. Y'all hear what I'm saying? How do I know it was a good day? Because I woke up this morning without a chalk outline around my body. I said, it's a good day. I am honored to be here. I want to thank Reverend Sims. I got a special shout out to my ministry family. Those are the ministers here at First Baptist Church. I love the ministers here. They are my brothers and sisters, and I love y'all. Y'all pray for me, and I know what I feel when y'all praying for me. So thank you. And then I got to say a shout out to my bride. Yeah, y'all know, God, stand up, my bride. Y'all got to see my bride. We're newlyweds. Y'all got to see my bride. We're newlyweds. Yeah, we're newlyweds. June 28th, we celebrated 28 years of marriage. I tell people privately, I tell them publicly, I would crawl over broken glass to get to that woman. You hear what I'm saying? I told her, I said, baby, one day I said, if you leave me, I'm coming with you. I am coming with you. So I am grateful for my wife. I'm grateful for her love and support over these years of this journey. And then I want to thank all of you, my First Baptist Church of Glenarden family, for all your support over these years with all my travel and all things that all of you have prayed. Today, when this is over, we've got some of my products and resources out in the Great Hall. We got my book, It Only Takes a Minute to Change Your Life. How many of y'all listen to me on WHUR every morning? If you don't listen, you got to get up early, listen to me right about 5:50 a.m., and then go back to bed, all right? That's what you do. All right, but it'll fire you up, give you a quick positive message. I am excited, though, if you got to go to Facebook, you can get me on Facebook with a positive message every day. We put a new message every day. And coming first of the year, you'll see me on, many people say, what happened to Channel 9? You were on Channel 9 every day. Well, you're going to see me on national television coming first of the year, and you'll also see me on my new website, and I want y'all to go to my website. It's called jollygoodnews.org. It's our ministry site, jollygoodnews.org. And we're going to have positive messaging there, And you can see the whole message from the Crystal Cathedral. And if you want some of my free resources that are on my regular website, go to williejolley.com/free. WillieJolley.com/free, and you get some free things. It only takes a minute to change your life. I'm from WHUR, from Channel 9. These one-minute messages that will inspire, empower, encourage you. I call it great bathroom reading. It's really good. It's a great book to read when you're in the bathroom, in the library. My second book that most people know, another book is called Turn Setbacks into Greenbacks. How many need some greenbacks? All right, so this book's about what do you do when you have a cash flow challenge? What do you do when the economy goes south? What do you do when you have an economic downturn, even if it's a personal one? 7 steps to get through that. Next book is Attitude of Excellence. How do you build your business and build your people and build yourself so you can build your success? And this is some of the ideas that I shared with Ford Motor Company. Next one is Chicken Soup for the Christian Soul. Number 2, and I'm on the front cover. I'm honored to be on the front cover with Joyce Meyer and Tony Campola. And this book is a book out of my grief. 2003, I lost my mother, my brother, and my father-in-law in 30 days. I was overwhelmed with grief. I didn't know if I wanted to go on. I didn't know if I could make it. I didn't know if I wanted to live. But by the grace of God, God did a miracle that was so powerful that it has changed my life. Millions of people around the world who've said they read this. It comes with a CD so you can read it and hear it. If you're dealing with grief, get this book. If you know somebody dealing with grief, get that. And the one that most people know me by, though, is what I'm gonna talk about today is a setback is a setup for a comeback. And this book has literally made my life an incredible journey. We've been traveling around the world as a result of this book. I want to thank all the preachers who have made it a bestseller. Bishop Jakes, Joel Osteen talk about it just about every week. A setback, nothing but a setup for a comeback. And I understand this new movie, The Best Man's Holiday, I hear they talk about it in that too. So I'm very grateful for all of the people. That was my goal, to make it part of the vernacular. So I'm grateful that I'll be available afterwards, and I'm grateful for that. I want to read a quick bit of scripture for you. Now, I think you might have read some scripture earlier, but I want to read this one little piece of scripture that inspires me. It inspires me because it's a different take on a message we've all heard. It's in 2 Corinthians, the 4th chapter, the 8th through the 12th verses. And it reads, don't fret. Oh, no, that's not the right one. That ain't what I wanted. It says, don't worry about stuff. It says, don't worry about the challenges and changes that come in your life. And it basically, he says that your best is yet to come. And your challenging times and your difficult times, summarizing it all, that your best is yet to come. And that's what I want you to hear today. This is a setback is a setup for a comeback. A setback, how many of you ever had a setback? Personal setback, professional setback, financial setback, relationship setback. Any of y'all got children? Anybody got teenagers? Bless you. You're going to have a couple setbacks along the way. But let me tell you, a setback is nothing but a setup for a comeback. See, God is the author of comebacks. God is the author of comebacks. In fact, God is an incredible comeback king. Jesus is a comeback king. They put him on a cross. They put him in a borrowed grave. They said, this is the end of the story. But he came back. It was amazing. God is a God of comebacks. And he got a comeback for you. But when we talk about a setback and set up for a comeback, we usually focus on the setback or the comeback. But the power point is the setup. That's the power part of that phrase. It's a setup. See, God is the ultimate setter-upper. That might not be good English, but as Pastor said, that's good preaching, all right? He is the ultimate setter-upper. He sets us up so that he can get the glory. Let's look at some examples. David was in the midst of a setup. There was this Philistine. And they said, we're going to let you go fight him. We're going to put on a coat of armor. The armor was so heavy, he couldn't even wear it. He said, I don't need that. I can't do that. It was a setup. Everybody said he's going to get killed. It was just a setup. He took a slingshot, a couple smooth rocks, and he killed the Philistine. But then he did something interesting, folks. He gave God the glory. Oh, let's look at Job. Job had all sorts of pain, adversity, difficulty. He lost everything. But it was all just a setup. Because he came back and got double for his trouble. But notice what he did afterwards. He gave God the glory. How about Joseph? Joseph was thrown in a pit by his brothers. He was lied on by Potiphar's wife. He was put in a prison. He went through all sorts of challenges and changes and difficulties. But it was just a setup. It was just a setup. Because he went from being in the pit to being in the palace, number two man in the palace. But what did he do afterwards? He gave God the glory. And then, of course, there was Jesus. Jesus went on the cross. He was put in a grave. He rose. And he took all power in his hand. But when he finished, he gave God the glory. Oh, you say, well, all those are just great Bible stories. What about today's stories? Well, this week we're celebrating the life of a man who spent 27 years in prison. It looked like a setback, but it was a set up. Because he did the prison time. When they asked him would he be willing to leave early if he would denounce the African National Congress, he said, no, I'd stay in here till I die before I accept apartheid. And he stayed in there and went through the challenges. And when he came out, he went from being in the prison to being the president. And by the way, he gave God the glory. Amen? So I'm saying to you folks, God is in the setup for your comeback business. He's setting you up with all the challenges, all the difficulties. It's a setup for your comeback. Now what you got to do, though, you got to give him the glory. He got to know that he can trust you. See, God will use those who he knows he can trust. Who he knows love him. It's about two things. It's about relationship and trust. Everybody say relationship. Relationship. You got to have a relationship with him. You got to have a relationship with him. And then you got to trust him. Amen? Relationship and trust. You got to have a relationship. Because see, we walk not by sight, but by faith. And we must trust him. Sometimes we cry out to God. God, our world is shaking apart. Our world is shaking apart. Only to find out that it's God who's doing the shaking. Sometimes God got to shake your life up to get your attention, to get your direction set, give you some introspection, some reflection, to get you to think differently. He got to shake your life up. And it's difficult. But once he starts changing your thinking, he'll change your future. And change your perspective. See, you maintain the status quo as it is, going through just difficulty after difficulty, or you can reframe, reshape that difficulty and say, I'm set up now. I'm getting set up. Oh, I'm on my way. Get ready, get ready, get ready. But it's about your thinking. Status quo, or is it time to grow to the next level of faith? See, it's all about adversity. Adversity is how we grow. We grow through the struggle. I love the story in my setback book about a little boy going through a forest. Comes upon an emperor moth, struggling to make the transformation from a moth to a butterfly. He looks at his struggles to get through the small opening in the cocoon. It struggles. An hour goes by, 2 hours. Finally, the little boy takes a penknife out, cuts a slit in the cocoon. Out falls a bug that is neither a moth nor a butterfly. It has big bloated body and small shriveled undeveloped wings. He sees it as it lies there on the ground. Fly, fly, you're supposed to fly. But it couldn't fly because its wings were undeveloped. He goes to get his grandfather. Grandfather, come, why won't it fly? He said, my son, what did you do? I cut a slit in the cocoon to make it easy so it wouldn't have to struggle. He said, my son, that's where the mistake was made. It is then going through that small opening and forcing his big body through the small opening that it forces the fluid out the body into the wings. Without forcing the fluid out the body into the wings will never develop. Without developed wings, the butterfly cannot fly. A butterfly that cannot fly will never survive in the wilderness. The moral of the story, life, ladies and gentlemen, is that life and flight are in the struggle. You must struggle. How many of y'all got children? When your children were babies, they crawled around. But miraculously, for the first time, one day, for the first time, they stood on their own 2 feet. What was the exact next thing they did? Fell down. But not one of you said, oh, stay there, baby. What did you say? Get up. Come to mommy. Come to daddy. The baby get up and fall down. You say, do it again. The baby get up and fall down. Say, do it again. Now, sometimes they fell on their backside. But sometimes they fell on their face. And you not only allowed them to fall on their face, you encouraged them to do it again. Because you knew if they never fell and got up, they never learned how to walk. They never fell and got up, they never learned how to run. They never fell and got up, they never learned how to maximize their potential. But some of us in this room have been knocked down. We've fallen down. Life has not been fair, and we've stayed there. And I came here today to say it's time to get up. It's time to get up and fly like you were born to fly. It's setback, but it's a setup. It's nothing but a setup. See, it's a setup. Adversity is how we grow strength. Proverbs 24:10 says, if you faint in a day of adversity, your strength will be small. There's a quote in another book I love that says, the greater the wind, the stronger the trees. You want strong timber? You got to have some adversity to push you through it. But folks, it's comeback time. And you cannot have a comeback if you've not had a setback. So it's time for us to come. God is still in the comeback business. When I had decided to write this book, I interviewed people who had had setbacks. Some of them were celebrities like Tina Turner, Lee Iacocca, John Travolta, Les Brown, Wally Famous Amos. But they were famous. What about us? What about people like us, workaday world people who might have had a setback? But people like us were the ones that changed my life. Like the young man I interviewed, had a small business, 2 small children, had a setback, went bankrupt, lost his house, lost his car, ended up living on the street. Many thought that would be the end of his story, but he came back and built a company called Daymark, one of the biggest merchandising companies in the country, $240 million a year company. Or how about the 9th grade math teacher I interviewed, Mrs. Doris DeBoe, who was told one day when she went to the doctor that they told her she had terminal breast cancer, given 6 months to live. She said, I can't die now. I got too many children to teach. They said, we're sorry, ma'am, but you got 6 months. She sat there for a few more minutes, gathering her thoughts. Then she stood back up and looked at the doctors in the eye and said, I just made up my mind. I'm not going to die. She said, I'm going to live for at least 25 more years because I got too much to do. They said, ma'am, the tests are conclusive. You got 6 months. And they sent her home to die. Well, I'm excited to say that lady lived for 33 more years. When I interviewed her, she told me that she had beaten cancer 4 times. And she said, write in your book, say it like this. I might have cancer, but cancer does not have me. She said, you tell them one other thing, and you write it like I say it. I say, yes, ma'am. She said, you tell them doctors can give you the diagnosis, but God gives you the prognosis. How about the lady going up the corporate ladder, struggling, fighting the fights, fighting the wars to get to the top of the corporate ladder, got almost up to the top of the corporate ladder, and they fired her. Told her she was too old. They didn't need her anymore. But she came back and bought the company. You're going to have some setbacks in this path called life. Not maybe, not might. You're going to have some setbacks. But I can tell you for sure, that a setback is nothing but a setup for your comeback. But there'll be 4 steps that you got to employ, 4 simple steps that you must employ if you're going to maximize your comeback opportunity. Step number one, write down this, to say the power of vision. Everybody say the power of vision. You got to have a vision. Scripture says without a vision, a people perish. But with a vision, a people will flourish. You got to have a vision. You got to start speaking into your life what you're going to want to happen. You got to start talking about what's going to happen. You got to talk it before it becomes a reality. You got to believe that it's possible. You got to have a vision. I love the story about Walt Disney. Walt Disney, as you all know, created Disneyland out in California. Some years later, he got a new idea, new vision. He wanted a place called Disney World down in Florida. He bought some swamp land in the middle of the state of Florida in Orlando area, and he filled it in, started building this place called Disney World. But then he got sick in the middle of the construction. He got sick and he died. Some years later, on opening day, a lady came up to his brother Roy and said, isn't it sad that Walt didn't get to see this? Roy said, sad? No, it's not sad. Because Walt saw it, that's why it's here. I'm saying to you folks, you got to start talking about your vision, where you're going. People are going to laugh at you. That's good. They're going to call you crazy. That's good. Because when they start talking about how crazy your vision, that's when things start to become a reality. That's when it starts. Acts 2:17 says, and it shall come to pass in the last days, says God, that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall see visions. Your young men shall dream dreams. You've got to have a vision. Everybody say the power of vision. Next, you got to make this, the power of decision. Everybody say the power of decision. Decision is taken from the Greek word to cut. If you make an incision, you cut in. You make a decision, you cut off. If you're going to be all that God wants you to be and maximize your potential in God's life and turn this setback into a comeback, you're going to have to cut off, number one, some of those negative, small-minded, itty-bitty, petty-thinking people in your life. Got to cut them off. And unfortunately, some of them are in your inner circle. They're people who you love. And they love you too. They're not trying to be mean-spirited. They just happen to suffer from possibility blindness. Oh, well, you say you want to start your own business? Baby, Uncle Bobby tried to start his business once. He ain't make it. It was painful. You best stay where you at. Bless your heart. Hey, man, what's up? You say you want to go back to school? Ain't you a little old to go back to school? Aunt Sally tried to go back to school one time when she was a little older. She ain't make it. It was painful, man. You best stay where you at. Bless your heart. People tell you it's painful out of their experience or something they heard about or something they found somebody else. But let me tell you something. It's painful either way. If you go out here and you struggle, it's going to be painful. If you stay where you're at, it's going to be painful. But if you go out here and you become the next Bill Gates, it's going to be painful. So I say you got to go through pain anywho, you might as well go for the gusto. Am I right about it? I know I'm right about it. You better, look, there will be people who talk you out of it. So first thing you got to do, you got to stay away from negative people. Look, Corinthians 15:33 says, do not be deceived. Evil company corrupts good habits. I make a hard and fast rule. I will not, do not, cannot hang around negative people. I don't care what. I don't hang around negative people. Now, I travel a lot. Y'all know I travel a lot. And the furthest trip I've ever taken in my life was to Australia. We go there once a year. That's 24 hours in the air. That's a long trip. And if you fly a lot, you know the one thing you hate, you despise, is somebody, when you get in your seat, here come by somebody down the aisle sneezing, coughing, runny nose, eyes watering, hawking. Oh, and I just be praying, please don't let them sit next to me. Please don't let them sit next to me. But let me tell you something, folks. I would much rather be on a trip from here to Australia with a person with the infectious flu than to be locked in a room with a negative person for an hour. See, if I get the flu, I'm only down for 2 weeks. But if I'm around a negative person, they may steal my dream for a lifetime. Don't you hang around negative people. When I see negative people, they start all that negative talk. I say, beep, 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 beep. Folks, I'm telling you, stay away from negative people. That's the first decision. Second decision you got to make. Now, this is a big one. This is a big one, big one, big one. Now, if you haven't gone to a certain level of school, you won't get this. I apologize in advance. But this is high-level thinking, all right? How many of y'all went to first grade? In first grade, they taught me, and they probably taught you the same thing, that there were two punctuation marks you needed to know to be able to read and write effectively. One is called a period, and one is called a comma. Now, a period means end of the sentence, no more to be said. In Australia and New Zealand, they call it a full stop. No more to be said, full stop, end of the sentence. A period, that's a period. A comma, though, is different. It means pause, transition. There's more to come. Just hang on, keep going. So when you have a setback in your life, you got to make a decision. Is this a setback, period, full stop, end of the story? Or is this a setback, comma, pause, transition? I encourage you to take the second decision. Because if you start to see it that way, you start to be it that way, and then you'll start to grow it that way. You must grow the action. First step is the power of vision. Everybody say the power of vision. Then the power of decision. Third one is the power of action. Action. A vision without an action is an illusion. An action without a vision is mere confusion. But a vision and action put together can give your life a transfusion. Nelson Mandela proved that. Mother Teresa proved that. We must take action on our dreams and goals, on whatever's going on in our mind or what we're struggling with, how we come out of it. We must take action. We must take action. Scripture says, ask and you shall receive. Seek and you shall find. Knock and the door will be open to you. For everyone that asks receives, everyone that seeks finds, and everyone that knocks, the door is open to them. Notice, it says when you take this action, that's when you get this blessing. Most people receive not because they ask not, they seek not, they knock not, and then they wonder why not. You must take action. I'm encouraging you. Take action. I had a young man who used to work on my house. He did handyman work, and then he disappeared. And one day, out of the blue, he rang my doorbell. Opened the door, there he was. He said, "How you doing?" I said, "Man, where you been?" He said, "Well, had a little trouble. I've been in jail." Sorry to hear that. He said, "You got any work you need done?" I said, "No, we just had all our work done just recently." He said, "Wow, I needed some money." I said, "Oh, don't worry. You've been always very good when you came and did work for us. Let me bless you with a little something." He said, "Okay, great." I gave him a little blessing. And then I said, "Look, why don't you come on go to church with me on Sunday?" He said, No, I don't need that church stuff. I don't need that God stuff." I said, "Okay, no problem. I said, I'm just going to ask you one question. I'm going to leave it alone." He said, "Okay." I said, "How's your way working for you?" He went to church with me that Sunday. He came here to First Baptist Church at Glenarden. He heard Pastor Jenkins preach, and he gave his life to the Lord. You must take action on whatever your goals. I'm encouraging you. As many of you know, I recently went back to school. This last year, I went back to school to get my doctorate of ministry. And thank you. And it was tough. It was hard. Because, you know, I've written a lot of books. The books are bestsellers. I'm very grateful. I write pretty good. So when I wrote my first paper, I took it to the dean. He looked at the paper, and he said, "Let me see you tomorrow when you come back in for a class." I went back in the next day. He took my paper. He tore it up. He said, "You write really good books, but your papers stink because they're out of what you already know. We want research-based papers. You got to go to the library." It was hard. It was humbling. But let me tell you, folks, I went through the process. I humbled myself. I had to do what I had to do. I had to go to the library. I had to shut it down for a while, just sit in the library with all the little 20-year-olds. But I kept doing it. And on May the 19th, I graduated from the California Graduate School of Theology. And let me tell you, I didn't just graduate, I also gave the commencement message that day. And that's something, I gave the commencement at my own graduation, and let me tell you something, I gave myself a good talking to. But we must take action. We must take action on the goals and dreams that you've been saying. I've been saying for 30 years I want to go back to school. Finally, I just said, I got to stop talking about it. But one lady came up to me one day and said, you know, if I go back to school now in 4 years, I'll be 58. I said, if you don't go back to school, how old will you be in 4 years? Everybody say the power of vision. The power of decision. The power of action. And last one is the power of desire. How bad do you want it? You have to ask yourself that question. How bad do you want it? How bad do you want it? And are you willing to be what God has set you here to do? See, I'm telling everybody what I learned about this doctoral program is that everybody in this room, once you accept the Lord Jesus Christ, you become a minister. Now, we got the minister staff here. They are licensed ministers, ordained. But you are unlicensed, unordained, but you're still a minister. See, you're deputized to do three things. Number one, you're deputized to help people seek to save the lost. Everybody, when you accept Jesus, you are deputized to seek and save the lost. Number two, you're deputized to seek to serve. You got to serve people. Martin Luther King said in his final sermon at Ebenezer Baptist Church, on his final sermon before he was assassinated, he said, you don't have to be great by being a college-educated person. It doesn't take knowing Aristotle and Plato. It doesn't need to know the second theory of nuclear physics. All you need is a heart of love and a soul generated by grace, and you can serve others. And that's being great. The greatest among us is the greatest servant. So you're first told to seek to save the lost, seek to serve, and the last one is seek to help people succeed. Because people need to be successful. People need. See, God's gift to us is life. Our gift to God is what we do with our lives. And we ought to live a life that's exceptional, that's amazing. I was saying to the people out in the hall earlier that I read a book recently that said, at the end of the book, it said, everything you do, whether small or big, make a commitment that you're going to be amazing. Amaze your customers, amaze your family, amaze them. Do more than you're expected to do. Give more than you're expected to give. Go further than you're expected to go. I've learned something in 25 years of speaking. I've learned if you do more than you're paid to do, one day you'll be paid more for what you do. Be amazing. So, the vision, decision, action, desire. Can he trust you to give him the glory? But more importantly, can you trust him to bring you out of your setback, past your setup, to the comeback? There was a story about a father had 8 children. He worked 3 jobs to take care of his 8 children. One day at the end of his 3rd job, on his way home after 3 shifts, he's walking home dead tired. He's walking toward a house, and as he gets close to the house, he looks in the distance, and there are fire engines in front of his house. He runs to the house, and people are running around. His house is on fire. His wife is running around. People are running around. He said, are all the kids out? She said, I think so. He said, line them up. They line them up. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Oh, do it again. Come on, get them all together. Come on. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Where's Jimmy? Where's Jimmy? And in the distance, he heard a little faint voice say, help, Daddy. Help, Daddy. They looked up in the attic window, and hanging out the attic window was a little boy. Smoke was billowing out the windows. There was flames coming up the side of the house. The father went to run to the house, but the fireman stopped him and said, the first floor is gone. The stairs to the attic are gone. We hope the hook and ladder truck can get here in time. The father heard the little boy say, help, Daddy! I need you, Daddy, help! The father got up close to that window, and he said, son, Jimmy, jump! But, Daddy, I can't see you. The smoke's in my eyes. I'm afraid. He said, jump, Jimmy, jump! But, Daddy, I don't know. I don't know if I can do it. I'm afraid, Daddy. I don't know if I can make it. It's so hard, Daddy. He said, jump, Jimmy. But, Daddy, he said, Jimmy, yes, trust me. And the little boy trusted the voice of his father. And he jumped. And his father caught him in his arms. God is calling some of you to jump. He said, jump, but I'm afraid. Jump, but there's smoke in my eyes. Jump, but because he lives, folks, you can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Just jump. Trust him. God sent his son. They call him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. He bled and died to buy my pardon.
By thy pardon.
An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because of the praise. He's worthy. Your setback is just a setup for your comeback. Oh, give God the praise. Let us stand to your feet, please. Everybody to your feet. You've heard the great music. You saw the incredible mime. You've heard the prayers. You've heard the scriptures. Now comes the most important part of this service. Do you know him? Do you have a relationship? I'm going to give you four calls. First, if you don't know him, you haven't ever given your life to the Lord, you need to come right now. Don't hesitate. Don't delay. Don't wait 1 minute. You come right this moment. If somewhere along the line you knew him, but you went another way, you fell off, you backslid, you said, well, I'm okay. But you know you need to reconnect. Come right now. If you have a question mark, if you don't know for sure where you're going to spend eternity, if you were to die today and you don't know for sure where you're going to spend eternity, you come right now. American Express says don't leave home without it. You don't leave this building without the Lord Jesus Christ connected to you. And the last one is if you need a good church. Let me tell you, folks, this is a good church. I'm honored to be a member of one of the greatest pastors that the world has ever seen. So, folks, you need a good church, come plug in here. Many of you have been coming for months. I spoke to a lot of people earlier. I've been coming for months, but I never joined. Now is your Sunday to join. You come on right now. Come on right now. Tomorrow is not promised. So if you don't have a church, if you don't know Lord Jesus, if you're not connected, if you knew him but you fell off, if you're not sure, or if you need a good church, come now. And I'll close with the one question that if you have any doubt, I simply ask, how's your way working for you? Amen. Amen. Amen.